Dumpsters, offensive matter, and standing water, chapter 21. We'll start with a pledge of allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm going to turn this over to the health officer and fellow selectman, Bill Kratz, to give you some background on what the ordinance is all about, and then we'll open it up for public discussion. Bill?
Yeah, thank you.
I'm just scrolling to it.
This is the public hearing. We had introduced this concept about a month ago, and I did get some valuable feedback from one of the construction managers here in town as a company. And we updated the ordinance from what we had originally. But given that we're in a commercial break, so you can't bring it on, let me read to you what I just got today from the state epidemiologist at the Department of Public Health. I had asked them to be up here last week, and they asked me what time our meeting started, and I said 5 o'clock, and there was this pause. And they said, we all go home around 4:30, but we'd be happy to support you if we could. So we're going to send you a letter. So let me read the letter. As you know, this is a dumpster ordinance to cover construction dumpsters so that water doesn't accumulate within the dumpsters. When the construction man was here at our last meeting, he raised the question, which is a good question, or a good point, that there are ponds all over town that generate mosquitoes. So why do we need to cover the dumpsters that are accumulating water after it rains? And what this is about is reduction of in source, not elimination of source, but reduction of source. When standing water gets past the fourth day, chemically it becomes attractive to mosquitoes to drop their eggs. So it takes 96 hours. Water that's now becoming stagnant is where they drop their eggs. Mosquitoes don't travel very far from when they're born. They don't visit relatives on the other side of the world like we do. But because we do, mosquitoes have come back here on planes and in boats that we're now more concerned about. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the dumpster and then some of the background to it. But let me read this letter very quickly. And I just got it this afternoon. So, dear Mr. Bratz, individuals from communities throughout New Hampshire are at risk of becoming infected and ill from mosquito-borne diseases. Residents are currently at risk for certain mosquito-borne diseases, including Eastern equine encephalitis and West Nile virus, which are transmitted through the bite of an infected mosquito. Additionally, while New Hampshire has not yet found populations of the mosquitoes that carry the Zika virus, it is possible that these mosquito species, Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus, could be introduced to the future. And I'm going to show you a map, because one of these two has reached Massachusetts. Sustainable populations of Aedes albopictus have been identified as far north as Massachusetts. Management of environmental conditions is critical to minimize the risk of exposure to mosquitoes and the diseases that they may carry. To prevent mosquito-borne diseases, individuals and local communities need to focus on preventing mosquito bites, which requires a multifaceted approach that includes controlling mosquito populations. Local communities are ultimately responsible for the mosquito control efforts in their jurisdictions. Up to a few years ago, the state actually had money that they would give out to towns to help control mosquitoes primarily through spraying, but that account was discontinued in 2012. However, to assist local communities, the New Hampshire Department of Health and Human Services, Division of Public Health Services, routinely updates and publishes online the State of New Hampshire Arboviral Illness Surveillance, Prevention, and Response Plan. And I'll show you some numbers from last year. This document discusses recommended strategies that local municipalities can take to control mosquito populations, including methods to reduce mosquito breeding habitats through an integrated pest management approach. Integrated pest management is a sustainable approach to manage mosquitoes by combining biological, cultural, physical, and chemical tools in a way that minimizes economic, health, and environmental risks. Your proposal to focus on eliminating mosquito breeding habitats is part of an effective integrated pest management system. Many of the mosquito species in New Hampshire are the type that breed and reproduce in containers where water and organic matter can accumulate, creating an ideal breeding habitat. Because of the current risk of mosquito-borne diseases, as well as the threat that new emerging mosquito-borne diseases like Zika pose to New Hampshire residents, we recommend and encourage all residents and communities in New Hampshire to minimize mosquito breeding habitat. Last summer, I think I sent out 17 letters to various residences where there were old tires, boats, wheelbarrows, things in the yards that were accumulating water, and adjoining neighbors or passerbys had filed complaints. So that's what this is about. It's not eliminating every possible source of mosquitoes, but just where there are populations around, we'd like to keep the dumpsters covered at night and when they're not being used to minimize water piling up. These are excellent resources available from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, as well as the New Hampshire Department of Health and Human Services that can support and guide your work to prevent mosquito-borne diseases. And then there's a number here. We are available to assist in your planning and prevention efforts, so please feel free to contact us if you have any questions at 603-271-4496. Sincerely, Benjamin Chan, MD, the State of New Hampshire epidemiologist. Epidemiologists study the source and distribution of diseases throughout the world. He presented a couple months ago on this topic of Zika coming into the eastern states, and that's why he was able to do this. So I appreciate his endorsement. So are we set to go here? Okay, let me just read again, and this is with added language based on what we received last time. Town of Littleton, dumpster, offensive matter, and standing water. I also have sent out letters to restaurants recently that have dumpsters that have allowed the garbage bags to fill up above the top of the lids. And as we all know, it attracts bears, it can attract rodents, and it can obviously attract a number of different kinds of vermin. In accordance with the authority conferred by RSA 147 upon selectmen, upon recommendation of the health officer relative to nuisances, toilets, drains, exportation, rubbish, and waste, the following regulations are hereby adopted. Preamble. This ordinance shall be captioned Dumpsters, Offensive Matter, and Standing Water, and shall take effect on its adoption by the Board of Selectmen. Dumpsters, whether temporarily on a property or there regularly in connection with ongoing use of that property, have the potential of creating risks to the public health. Open dumpsters attract vermin or larger animals that may be infected with rabies virus or other viral infectious agents, and therefore pose a threat to humans and pets who inadvertently come in contact with them. Additionally, mosquitoes have enormous breeding capacity during warm weather months in small puddles of water lasting more than 4 days, and standing water collects in dumpsters that are not properly closed or covered. Mosquitoes carry Eastern equine encephalitis and West Nile virus, serious viral diseases that may be transmitted to humans. If any word, term, phrase, sentence, or clause of this ordinance is found to be invalid by any court of competent jurisdiction or any other agency, such finding shall not affect the validity of any other word, term, phrase, sentence, or clause of this ordinance. Definitions. Dumpsters, containers designed for receiving, transporting, and dumping waste products. Standing water, H2O that is not flowing, remains stationary for 96 plus hours between June 1st and October 1st of any given year. Those are the months primarily where mosquitoes drop their eggs. Offensive matter, as defined by RSA 147.13, includes exposed, unburied, any animal or other substance liable to become putrid or offensive or injurious to the public health. Dumpster cover. this is new language. Correctly fitted, waterproof, industrial vinyl, hand or throw tarp. Second section, required actions, dumpster doors and top lids are to remain closed at all times except when receiving garbage, trash, or debris. Open dumpsters without lids, regardless of size, must be covered with a properly fitted cover, except when receiving garbage, trash, or debris. Enforcement. Enforcement against any person who or business that violates this ordinance shall be in accordance with RSA 147, including the option of a charge of criminal violation and or court injunctive action. In addition to any other remedy established by law, the selectman shall be authorized to enforce the provisions of this ordinance by any proceeding commenced by the Grafton County Superior Court or the Littleton District Court, and shall be entitled to recover from any violator hereof all their costs, including attorney's fees and connections with such enforcement to the extent allowed by said court. Mr. Chairman, I have a number of other things. Do you want to stop at this point and ask for questions, or should I run through all of it?
I think you should finish your presentation and then we'll have questions.
All right, thank you. The next slide talks about the two illnesses that we have had in New Hampshire. We haven't had them in a number of years now, but this is the two that they refer to in the letter. Eastern equine encephalitis is a rare but serious viral disease that is also caused by a virus transmitted by the bite of an infected mosquito with more severe symptoms than West Nile virus. Eastern equine is an arbovirus, short for arthropod borne, meaning spread by insects. Birds are the source of the infection for mosquitoes, which can sometimes transmit the infection to horses, other animals, and in rare cases, people. West Nile virus was first seen in the U.S. in 1999 in the New York City area of Queens. West Nile virus can live in a number of types of birds and is passed bird to bird by certain types of mosquitoes. Occasionally, an infected mosquito will pass the virus to humans or other animals. Most healthy people do not get sick from the virus, but sometimes it may cause symptoms. When a human gets ill from West Nile virus, they may have symptoms including encephalitis, which is the inflammation of the brain, or meningitis, inflammation of the lining of the brain, and spinal cord. Encephalitis and meningitis can also be caused by head injury, bacterial infections, and other viral infections. Okay, so these are the two that we're most concerned about now. And I'll show you the mosquito that, they all look kind of alike, but I'll show you the mosquito that carries it. It's the northern brown mosquito. Can you flip to the next? These are where the three dumpsters were located in Littleton last summer. One was behind the bank off of Cottage Street. I'm walking down the street name right now. But it's where there's a large section of apartment houses. It was an enormously large dumpster as long as this room. And they were piling, I think when people were moving from the apartments, they were leaving stuff behind and they were throwing it in this dumpster. Dumpster had about 8 inches of water in it. Dumpsters are supposed to have drain holes. The drain holes get plugged, but also sometimes the dumpsters have the drain holes on their sides, near the bottom, not on the bottom. And so water can accumulate. A thimble can be enough to drop millions of eggs. So there was this one, and then the high school is right here. There was one in one parking lot and one in the other parking lot. Most mosquitoes don't fly very far. There are ponds around here, okay? So we're not talking about getting rid of all of the water in town that can drop mosquito eggs. We're talking about reducing the source as much as we can. And all three of these dumpsters, and it was through no fault of the companies that dropped them, they were in these areas because they were doing work in the high school, and also they were, taking things out of apartments that had been vacated. Okay, I'm going to transfer. Okay, the Egypti virus, which is down in Florida, has come up this far. This one we don't think is going to be the one that's going to come north, primarily because of the weather. In the winter, it's too cold. This one, the Aedes aegypti, is the one that's carried it is known to carry it up as far as Massachusetts. In fact, the yellow goes into New Hampshire above to Laconia, but we haven't found any here in New Hampshire. As our springs start earlier and our summers end later, the possibility of indigenous people in particular moving into our area is there. The possibility of the mosquito carrying the Zika virus is minimal, if not almost non-exempt. Anyway, the reason why I'm saying this, when you read the second page of this map, can you flip to it quickly? It gives you all the things that you shouldn't be worried about. What it does tell you, though, is that this one mosquito that carries the Zika virus has been found in Massachusetts, but without the virus attached to it. My obligation, not as a selectman, but as a health officer, is to address this issue as best I can. West Nile and Eastern Equine Encephalitis have occurred in New Hampshire in the past. We haven't had it in the past few years. So if you flip to the next one, this is the one that we don't think will come up the Egypti because it's clearly a warm weather mosquito. This is the one that has made it as far as Massachusetts. This is our brown mosquito that we all know and love as the summer goes on. And the following three are as to worry about. They're out west in California, Mexico, and those areas. So it's just those three that we're addressing, and it's primarily just the one brown mosquito right now that can potentially carry West Nile virus and Eastern Equine. Okay, so this was last year's report. The last one I got was in September 17. Among humans, they had done 31 tests. They have found no West Nile virus positive, no Equinetonide positive, anything else. Among animals, they did 6 tests, they found nothing. Among mosquitoes, and they take, downstate, and you'll see the map, they take batches of mosquitoes, they separate them by whatever trap they were in, and what kind they may be that's a derivative of that eastern or that northern brown one. And they found basically, they tested 1,496. They found one positive West Nile virus and not no equine, eastern equine. So, we're not having a problem right now. But we're proposing covering the dumpsters anyway. And I know this is a cost to people that are running construction companies, but it may at some point become the cost of doing business anyway. We're doing this voluntarily at this point. You'll notice the letter I read. He didn't endorse, the state epidemiologist did not endorse the statute, but he did endorse controlling open water. Okay. You can move beyond that one as well. Here's where they do the testing downstate. So there's no testing up here at all. And it's in these counties and in these townships where they're tracking most closely. And for our purposes, that's probably the most important area to do. Again, the legislature cut the funding to this control program a few years ago, so there's not a whole lot of it going on, but there is a little bit. Okay, the dumpsters. The dumpsters, and this all came as part of the last meeting as a recommendation because the question was, what are you talking about for covers? And the one construction company I did watch was right across the street at Social Security. And I don't remember what the name of the construction company was that was renovating the offices. But they were covering their dumpsters at the end of the day. And that's when I found out that this was actually happening. So these costs are $213.50 for 11 foot by 25 foot. These are just some examples from one company. I'm not endorsing this product necessarily, but this just gives you an example. And the next slide will give us a range that goes from $62.76 up to close to $375. So this is a cost for construction companies or people that are using dusters that are open on the top, because we'd like to have them covered so we can attempt to control as best we can and reduce standing water that's over 96 hours old. And that's basically the presentation, except I just want to touch very quickly, if I can find it, here it is. Is that the last slide you had?
That's the last slide.
Yeah. In 2003, this was in one of the newspapers a few weeks ago, it was in the Sunday News magazine. In Dallas, Texas, in 2003, they had 60 cases of West Nile virus, and then it went away, and so the statistics look just like ours. In 2012, they had 1,760 cases, and a number of deaths. All of a sudden, it sprang up, and they had a major epidemic. So I bring this to your attention and to my own attention just to remind us that potentially, because of those two mosquitoes, we're at risk. Our summers are getting longer, and we're at risk. So that's my presentation. And again, we don't have any control here of mosquitoes here in town. There's no spraying that's done, and the state no longer supports spraying anyway. So that's what we got. So I'll take questions at this point.
Well, we have two things. You can ask questions about the presentation, or you can make comments on the ordinance, or both.
Thank you.
We're open to any kind of comment or question.
Yes, sir.
You said the mosquitoes spread these diseases from bird to bird. Is there any possibility that migratory birds can bring a disease up from the sun?
Could be. I mean, they're affected. The birds carry the infection. They're the vectors. They're the ones that carry the infection initially. Mosquitoes bite the birds, and then they bite us. And a mosquito biting a bird that's infected may not get it, but also may get it. If you find dead birds laying on the ground, and if they look freshly dead, whatever that means, call me or call the office and let them know that you found them. The state will only pick it up if I pick it up first. Some years ago, they'd come up and they'd have somebody else pick them up, but I'll try to find them. It'll ultimately kill the birds, but it's the mosquitoes that we're primarily concerned with. And again, because all of us are flying around the world now, we're bringing some of this stuff back. Both of these illnesses, both Zika and West Nile and Eastern Equine encephalitis, come out of Africa. And they've come over on ships and planes and people's luggage. And our ground mosquito, the one that I'm sure will last, will probably get up into your attics and mine this winter, and they'll stay there waiting for spring, and they'll come back down. So they can last. But they don't travel far. That's the key point here. So the ponds that are around town, they're not going very far from those ponds. If you drop a dumpster right in the center of a residential neighborhood, that's where the potential can be. So we're never going to get rid of the water, but we want to reduce the amount of water if we can. Any other questions?
It's not a question, but I have a comment. I live on Railroad Street, and I am fortunate enough to live next door to Brian's Automotive and Costello Waste Systems. And we have, this morning there were 5 dumpsters out there in the back of the building that belong to Costello, plus the one beside the building that Brian's Auto uses that puts their trash in. We finally got them to put in a bear-proof dumpster. It took us a long time to get them to understand that they had to close the lid and put the bar up to make it bear-proof, but they finally done that. But the bear are over there all the time, so it's not just mosquitoes. I mean, the bear, the birds, the mosquito, it's horrible.
That's why the ordinance, you know, our attorney, or one of our town attorneys, he wrote the ordinance, you know, in legal form. That's why it became a criminal offense in part, because it's not only just having the bears, it's having a bear that may also be sick, or a vermin that may also be sick and it's something else. What I've done up to this point is sent out letters of courtesy identifying the law and what's been found, and thanking them for their cooperation and from like I hear. So far, everybody's cooperated. So that's one that I hadn't heard of, and you know, I'll try to address that as well. We all know about the bears coming into town at night. It's more the other issue now with standing water as well as and other vermin as well. I watched a movie that this epidemiologist showed us. He was in New York and he was studying rats at night, and he was laying on the grates and he had his camera, and the rats came up from the grates and went and fed, you know, in the dumpsters and that sort of stuff. And then they would go back down and then he walked up to a large pile of garbage bags that had been left out on the sidewalk. And he kicked one, and about seven rats ran in various directions. So we have rats up here, we have rodents up here. We don't have a major problem, but sure enough, you leave enough garbage bags up, we'll have more of them. Thank you. Anyone else?
Are there any further questions or comments? I encourage questions because there is going to be a test before you leave.
Even though I can't pronounce the words properly.
Commander Timothy Mance, Christian Game.
Oh, thank you for coming.
Certainly. I'm very supportive of your efforts and commend you for that. I have a letter of support. But I want to take it a little bit further and follow up on this woman's comment regarding bears as well as some of her other critters that have a tendency to focus on unsecured gardening. Garbage and bears and open dumpsters are a big issue to deal with statewide. Up about 600 to 700 bear complaints a year. Close to 40% of those are direct relation to open dumpsters. So, you know, us as an agency, as well as our federal partners, as well as town PDs, deal with the issue a lot. So I'd encourage, you know, if you're in the process of formulating ordinance to address dumpsters, I'd encourage you to take it a step further and look at steel top dumpsters that are lockable. These plastic tops are not going to be adequate for bears as well as other species like raccoons. Littleton, interestingly, ranks the fourth highest town in terms of annual bear complaints. So that in the last 5 years, we've had bear issues in 229 towns. So 225 towns have less than Littleton. So as far as bear-human conflicts, Littleton is certainly at the top of the list. And the vast majority of those are due to garbage, specifically open dumpsters. So, you know, it is an issue. And if you're talking about human safety concerns, rabies issues really need to be on the table, probably more so than these mosquito-borne diseases. Town of Lincoln, as well as four other towns in New Hampshire, have adopted ordinances to address these attractants. Even the town of Pittsburgh has an ordinance regarding dumpsters, but in that town, it's specific to commercial dumpsters. In Lincoln, after the passage of an ordinance, they saw a reduction in bear conflicts by 85% in just 2 or 3 years. So, you know, ordinances are an effective tool at addressing the attractants and bringing these critters in around people, causing conflict. So I really commend you on your efforts, and I would just like to submit this letter of support.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? Questions or comments? There being none, we will close the public hearing.
And thank you, sir.
We will deliberate and make a decision in the relatively near future. Good timing, Bill. It's 5 o'clock.
Oh, yeah.
Time to start our regular selectmen's meeting. I will close the public hearing and open the selectmen's meeting.